In this interview, we're joined by Zanana Akande, who was elected to the Ontario Legislature way back in September 1990. And then she became the first female black cabinet minister in Canada. Zanana is going to tell us the story about her path to power, her accomplishments, and her disappointments in office. We'll also learn about Zanana's fascinating history growing up in Toronto, in Kensington Market, and her initiative to start the first journal by women of colour called Tiger Lily. And, of course, she's going to tell us the story about the groundbreaking employment equity legislation that she passed through the Ontario Legislature. Would you like to introduce yourself, Zanana, please?
Well, I'm Zanana Akande. I was elected to the Ontario Legislature in 1990, September 1990. And apparently it was a trailblazing, sort of, in that I was the first Black woman to be elected to the Ontario Legislature. And found out after that I was the first woman to become a cabinet minister anywhere in Canada, which was a surprise to me because I actually thought that Rosemary Brown had been named a cabinet minister in BC and was surprised to find that she had not. Mm-hmm. Such a talented and bright woman. But so there it was.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. So how do you think, what were the origins of this fantastic trailblazing career that you had?
Well, one would love to have a story that said it was built up to, I decided when I was 12 that I was going to run for government, but that's not true. Actually, I had worked in many people's elections. I had campaigned for them or counted votes or been there when they took votes. And it was generally the NDP and long before it was even named the NDP. And I found that their politics and my beliefs seemed to run neck and neck. And so I stayed with it. I'd been on committees for the New Democratic Party and actually was serving on a committee when I was asked to run. I had been asked before and said no. I was a school principal when I decided to run. And I decided to run only because I looked at their platform and when they asked me, and I thought there are three issues on there that I can speak to. I wasn't thinking in terms of, I'm sure I'm going to win. It was nothing like that. But they had anticipated that I would run in an area that had more, a larger Black community. And I said, no, I'm going to run here, in where I live, or I won't run at all, because I wasn't great about flying candidates. So that's really the beginning. That's really, I really had a belief in politics. My father is from the Barbados, and he was always very determined about teaching us about politics and about the way the world worked according to him. And how our involvement was one of the rights for which we had fought, and so therefore we should take advantage of it and be involved. But my involvement never included in my expectations running, never did.
So that's interesting. So were you born in the by Barbados, or were you born in Canada?
No, I was born right here in Toronto. In Kensington, actually.
Oh, right. Yeah. So you grew up in the market.
I grew up in the market, in and around the market. And those are my roots. In fact, my parents, though, are from St. Lucia and Barbados, and both of them had taught and been in education in Barbados. So, of course, you know, their influence was ever there. They were members of the Liberal Party way back then, and later changed, I might say, moved into something that was more reflective of their beliefs. And I went to school here, Harvard Collegiate, you know, U of T. I was ever so grateful that we had a first-class university right around the corner. So it became not only convenient, but it became the base.
So when did you first get involved in politics, would you say? Was it through the NDP, or were there issues and movements that you were involved in prior?
I went to school with, I went to high school with Stephen Lewis. And even before that, you know, my parents, so I lived across the road from Stuart Smith, who was later proclaimed a communist. And so the views and the discussions in my home and the talks that we as children would have with Stuart Smith, I was a friend of his daughter, and they lived right across the road from us after I moved. So it all contributed to my interest in politics. And the fact that we were taught to trace our benefits, that's what my father used to say, trace your benefits to the political party that's giving you, that's speaking for you, that's giving them to you. And I'm still teaching kids to trace their benefits, but now they're my grandchildren. Some of them are too young to teach, but the older ones get my message. They may not agree with it, but it teaches you to look to who is supporting you from your position. And so that kind of thing never leaves you, I think, if it's given to you early enough. And if you see the truth of it. And so, you know, moving into to other things, I remember when I was on the United Way board, and I met some people who were very involved also in politics from other parties. And I have worked in other people's elections, too. I have worked who weren't New Democrats. I've worked in liberals' elections. I mean, certainly women, Black women, who attempted to be elected in the provincial government. I've worked in Bev Salmon's election, who ran municipally. You do those things which are helpful. And I thought that having our faces in the realms of politics, no matter what party, and our opinions would be a beneficial thing. And so, of course, I put my elbows to the job.
What about the Congress of Black Women then? Was that one of the first organizations, say, that you were involved in with Black women?
I think it was. I think I was involved in the Congress even before I was involved with the Canadian Negro Women's Club. The Congress it was formed later, at least in my knowledge it was. I became involved because there were people that I met and that I knew were involved, and they invited me to come and to experience what it was like. And it was comfortable to have a group to discuss things, who saw things from your own framework, and who were dedicated to moving the issues along. it was helpful to you because sometimes, and especially when I was younger, there were relatively few Blacks. It's not like it is today. I mean, at one point we all knew each other or knew of each other. And somebody'd say, oh, so-and-so on Euclid Street. And you'd say, oh yeah, the such and such family, because there were so few of us. And sometimes in a situation like that, when you're spending most of your time with people other than Black people, you begin to feel, well, you know, maybe my view is extreme. Maybe I have to be more patient about my expectations and about my demands. And that patience sometimes takes a hold of you in a way that you begin to not accept, but to allow things that ordinarily you'd say, well, just a minute, that's not, you know, because you're there and you're by yourself. And who wants to make the speech at a party? Who wants to be the one to, you know, to call everybody's attention? And so you acquiesce to things that after a while you say, I don't believe I allowed people to say, I mean, not direct insults, but it, what passes as humor sometimes is somewhat aggravating. So it, being with the Congress of Black Women allowed discussions, and somebody'd say, you know, and even if you weren't discussing that particular point, it would raise an issue. And you'd say, you know, I felt exactly the same way. It was, I remember saying to people, you know, this is so comforting because I spend my days, my weeks with and see relatively few Black people in that situation. And here we're talking about things that I've thought about and put to the back of my mind. So it was comforting. And then they did other things that seemed to move the ticket along. They had programs where they spoke about issues. They sponsored speakers coming in. It was in fact very comforting, and I think rather my first move into a sisterhood that looked like me.
Yeah, oh, fantastic. Yeah, do you remember any sort of actions or campaigns they undertook?
I don't remember any real campaigns. I know that they had speakers often from the States who would come and speak to various issues. And I also remember that they'd have socials and they always turned into discussions. I mean, you can't get 10 Black women together, let alone more than that, without there being some discussion about something that's happened somewhere to somebody. And it was healthy. I must say that. It's extremely healthy. I had found the same health with groups of women around different issues. But around groups of Black women, I found that health, that feeling that you're not strange, you're not super sensitive, you are normal, and this is average. And more than that, you're quite right to feel it's inappropriate. And we've had the same experiences as women, haven't we? We've accepted things for years and then later took a look at it. And I remember the first time I read The Sisterhood is Powerful, and I kept saying, yes, yes. My husband said, I really think that you should put that book down. But there is an identification with that, isn't there, with certain things. That, and the same was happening to me with the Congress of Black Women. Mm-hmm. So I found it interesting.
That's good. Oh, great. Now, what about Tiger Lily? This was another project with women of color, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, Anne Wallace was one of the women that was asked to come to speak to us at the Congress. And she had published other things before and written. She was fantastic and very, very interesting. And we became friends. And also at that time, there was Gloria Fowlick, I met her there at the Congress, and we all started to talk and discuss and the very issues that I've just been referring to before, and said, you know, we should put out a women's magazine that I said, well, gee, there's a million of them. You know, there weren't as many as there are now, but there were women's magazines. And she said, no, that focuses on the issues of women of color. She said, we'll call it, you know, we talked about, well, what would we call it and how would we do? And I think it was Gloria Fowlick who came up with the idea that tiger lily is a flower that grows in, everywhere except in white. And we thought, well, that's significant. Well, we'll do that. So we called it Tiger Lily, and Anne was really the leader in that because this was familiar territory. She knew about publishing. She knew how to go about it. And we started talking about different people that we could get to write certain things. And or to deal with certain topics. And I remember Arun Mukherjee, who was teaching up at York University, and Dora Knipp, who's is now, I think she's with OHRC, various people that we would have contribute to the magazine so that it wasn't just our writing. But every time I wrote for the magazine, I wrote about education. After all, I was a teacher and a consultant and a principal. So, I mean, those were issues that not only that I was familiar with, but that I was angry about, and some of the situations that I'd run into in education. So, but there were Gloria was working with the municipal government when North York was separate, and she had a lot of interest and perspectives about employment, and she was from the States, so she also had a wider vision, you know, in terms of comparing. And Anne had lived in several different places, and England and Europe, other parts of Europe, and here in Canada. And she was a real go-getter and knew so many things about so many things. So it worked out well. It wasn't long enough. I couldn't stay with the magazine. As a matter of fact, I forgot about the fact that since it was a nonprofit magazine, I hadn't realized that it would be an issue, and it was brought up in the House, as you I don't know if you recall, and I had to it was examined by the commissioner of, you know, what to see whether it was okay for me to have it to be associated with it. Yes, oh yes. Yeah, it was.
Okay, so I didn't realize the timing went into your being. Oh, it did. Oh, okay. I thought it was 80s, but of course, it
It
actually
started.
there were quite a few issues, weren't there?
Yeah, yes, there were. There were.
Right. It's so good we have those issues. I don't know if we have them all, but we have a number of them on the
Yes.
website, and it's really interesting. So I'm glad to have those. And I guess you've kept in touch with those women, have you?
Well, I unfortunately, Gloria Fowlick died a few years ago here, and Anne, I cannot trace Anne. She went to Europe, and she may well be dead. I cannot trace her. And of course, with Gloria has a daughter here, and you know, she and my son and her daughter, you know, knew each other, but or Anne has no children. And so I have not been able to find out. I would expect that she may well be gone too, because Anne was a bit older than we were, not much, but somewhat.
Great.
So,
Oh, anyway, great work. It is wonderful to
it was
see that.
fun. It was really fun. It was therapeutic.
Oh yes, it must have been actually, and it must have felt creative to pull together all those,
Well, yeah,
that work actually. It was a creative body of work, wasn't it?
it was, and we weren't looking at it so much. Like people said, now that was, a tremendous business, and I thought, we never thought of that. I mean, we were at the stage, maybe Anne, and thank God we had her. She was really, but every time someone wrote for us, I remember Dora Knipp's article, and I remember Arun, every different person of color who wrote for us, it was something else for you to look at and to consider and to think, oh my God, they have that thought too, or gee, I never thought of it that way, and to consider the perspectives that were not being reflected in the mainstream. And I thought, what a loss, what a loss, for them not to have the value of seeing the various perspectives that were out there, but not being milked, not being reflected. And I've always thought that the differences in groups is really the major advantage of having groups. I mean, I always told my husband, where two people always agree, one of them's unnecessary. And I feel that particularly when you're in a group. You find some groups that they're all, yes, we all think the same way, and you think, oh, I have to get out of here.
Yeah, right. That's yes, I know what you mean. I'm not sure I always agree, but anyway. But actually that's very interesting, because how would you compare that to today then, do you think? I didn't ask you this question, but it comes up naturally that you are at that point in your life experiencing all these aha moments about understanding how your thinking and activity and everything is not being reflected in the mainstream. We all think that continues, doesn't it? Or do you think
Well,
it's
it does continue, and it's funny because there are more magazines, there are more articles, and you can look through the paper and you see the reflection of various views in the articles and in what's printed in some of the papers. But there are also those issues that the mainstream reflects the old standard point of view. But the marvelous thing about today is that nobody, or at least no one that I know well, is shy about saying, well, I don't think that. That may be what he thinks, or that may be what the way it's put there, but I'm quite prepared to contradict it and feel comfortable about it. And I think that comfort level has been fought for by various people and by the realities of our lives. I'm here because I'm here. I adjust to certain things because I can't change them, but that doesn't mean I'm not going to try to push and to change them so that my kids and my kids' kids aren't going to have to live according to a mold that they've outgrown and they've outlasted and should be broken anyway. So it's not denying others of their opinion, it's making sure that the breadth of opinions is reflected in what we say and what we do. And that's still a fight, but we will continue to do it. And it's interesting because no matter how wide you think, oh boy, that's it. And if you rest for 2 minutes, it goes right back to that narrow view, and you think, here we go again. And you have to wedge it over.
right. It's a lot of work, isn't it?
It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yes.
So did this also naturally lead into your interest and keenness on the employment equity issue, would you say? Or did that come after government or in government?
Well, it was the last act. I thought, you know, when I get employment equity, that was one of the three things that really influenced my decision to run. I said, well, let me see the platform when they asked me, and I, you know, what's the platform? And I looked at it, and there were three things that came that really said, well, I can speak to these issues. And that was long-term care, because as I've said so often, old women are poor women. They come in and out of the work situation because of children, because of parents who have to be taken care of for various reasons. And in my time, not so much today, we're working at a lower, much, much lower salary. And even sometimes doing the same job. I was teaching, and at that time, early days, the women and the men earned different salaries for the same job when I started. So for various reasons, old women are poor women. Their husbands die and they take their pensions with them. There wasn't the changes in legislation that allow for some of that carryover as it is today. It was terrible. So long-term care was one of the reasons, and it's strange because look at how it's come up in our view today, right in our faces. The second thing that I was really interested in was education. And that's integrated services for children. Immediately before I ran, I was on Charles Baer's committee. Charles Baer was the minister, the head of the Minister of Community and Social Services, the very ministry that I took over. And he had initiated a committee of people outside and inside the government to look at continued services for children so that you didn't have health blocking hair and then have to wait for social services to come in if the child needed that and separate from education. So I was interested in that, and especially in education, because I thought that some children were being treated unfairly, unwisely, in a way that was less than appropriate, and that would disservice them and Canada all at the same time. So I was very interested in that. And the last was employment equity, because I would have hoped that it would not have been necessary. I mean, because we all went to school together and we all lived together and we were friends. But when it came to employment, it turned out to be very necessary, and very qualified people were not able to get the jobs for which they applied. And people told you, I mean, when I left grade 13, I thought I'll work for a year and then go to university, because we had no money and they had no student loans at that time. And I was told by an insurance firm, we've never had a Black person work here. Just like that. Just like that. And it was, I thought, oh my God, you know, I mean, and it was the reality. And there were several instances of that. That was minor. That was nothing.
But it must have been undermining. I mean,
oh, it's very undermining.
Yeah,
I had come out of what was considered, because at that time they evaluated schools. So Harvard Collegiate had the highest scholastic standing in Canada, and weren't we proud of that? And Jarvis was second. And I remember feeling like, oh my God, They're rejecting me. And it wasn't as though I hadn't heard about it before. It wasn't as though I hadn't, my family and other people talk about it. It wasn't as though, but I was still affronted that, yet you're like, what are they talking about? It's happening to me. And it happens in many ways. Or you'd go into a job and never move. It's still that way at the civil servants in Ontario. They've done a report, and we're waiting for it to come out. It's this there. So I thought employment equity was extremely important, and those things were why I moved in that employment equity way. I was determined that you know how when governments get elected, the most important thing in their mind is the next election, and they kept putting in. I kept thinking, when's employment equity going? And it just wouldn't, So I sort of encouraged a group to become a little more aggressive. Rosario Marchese and Jenny Carter, a group of us, about seven of us, pushed and brought it to the caucus. And there were those who still resent us, I guess, or resent the fact that it was an issue, and blame their losing the election on the passing of employment equity. But I say it should have been done early so that in the next 4 years or 5 years they would have gotten accustomed to it. But I'm very proud of that. I think that when you put it on the platform, certainly you have to establish your priorities. But if people aren't among them, why are you there?
Very good point. Yes, exactly. So, okay. I tell me first of all. I want to talk more about the employment le equity le legislation, but tell us a little bit about the road to getting elected first.
As I said, they wanted me to run somewhere in Scarborough, and I said, they won't buy me. I said, I don't know why. And they asked why. And I said, I have no idea why, but I can tell you that they won't buy me. And they were very persistent. They wanted to know. And I wasn't avoiding telling them. I was being sincere. I said, I do not know why, but they will not buy me. For some reason, I'm somewhat suspect. Maybe because I wasn't right from the islands, but there were others that weren't. So I don't know why. And I said, besides which, I'm not keen on fly-in candidates. I said, it looks like I'm searching for a vote for rather than they want me to represent them. So they acquiesced, and they let me run where I live, and it was interesting because it was, you know how they say parties are not voted in, they're vote others are voted out, and I think it's true. The Liberals were having a lot of trouble because of the power they had given the apartment owners to raise rents over, fixing a window or whatever for relatively minor things. And many of the community in Castlefield in the areas where there were many apartment livers there who had sold their homes and older people moved into those apartments. So the raising of rents was very a contentious area, and they resented it. And I think it was unfair. I really did believe it was unfair. And they were angry for some reason with the PC. So, you know, it was a time of listening. And I ran on those, mainly on those three issues. I mean, certainly, and tied them to the budget. But I found down in the annex, there were many students from the U of T that were living in there, and there were a lot of profs living in there. So there was a lot of support because we were certainly not encouraging or espousing any idea about raising the tuition fees. We were going to keep those tuition fees as regular as possible. There were women in the area, and I had a lot of nerve, but I did say that most, I used to say to them, many women are living one man away from welfare. And they would look at me like, you know, I mean, this is not the idea, the area to talk about, but there are women who suffered at that time, extreme circumstances in wars over divorce that were like unbelievable. And you thought, you know, you might as well lay it on the table. All they can do is be shocked and angry. And I did speak a great deal about long-term care because it's so funny that it's come up again. And I think, oh, how strange, because I was really worried that our seniors were suffering and that many of them were not on welfare in this area, but were living by the good ages of their children, even though they had sponsored their development. I found that, you know, sort of scary. Some of them were rather uncomfortable about it. And you'd meet them in different places and they'd say, oh yes, I live with my daughter, you know, or whatever. So those, that was my I thought I can speak to those issues. I feel comfortable speaking to those issues. And you know, and other issues too. I you know, and certainly the budget, the budget, the budget.
And it's always hard running a campaign, isn't it? Or being the candidate. Very
Always.
stressful and lots of hype going on about whether you're going to win or not and
Yes,
all that kind of thing.
And my kids were well, one daughter was what, 15. The other one was 20 and she was off at university. And so she came back for the summer and my son was in law school. So, you know, we were constantly, my son worked for me. I didn't know. I said, how come you're, I thought he was volunteering. And he said, oh no, the campaign has, you know, and I said, oh, are you getting paid for this? Yeah, working in the summer was a biggie in our family. But he said, well, he said, I'm here. He said, I think that I should. So he had quit his job to come and work for me. And my daughter, the one had come back from UBC. She was quite comical. She's always quite comical. I remember we went to, one funny story is we were canvassing on Madison, and I think it was Madison, and this woman came out. And she was so excited when I rang the bell, and she said, "Oh," she said, "I'm so excited, and you're a Black woman, and you're running for election, and I'm going to vote for you." And she called her daughter, and she said, "Come and meet this woman." And she was just really excited. And my daughter left me on the porch and went down onto the sidewalk to wait. And when she was finished, I went down to join her and thank the woman. And I said to my daughter, I said, you know, I really don't want her to vote for me because I'm a Black woman. And my daughter, who's extremely comical, she just looked at me and she said, don't worry, Mom. She said, there'll be just as many people who won't vote for you for exactly the same reason. So I thought, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, she just put it right back into perspective. You know, and I laughed and I thought, yeah, you're right.
That's fantastic. So what were the memorable moments, you think, of being in government?
The memorable moments. Oh, I think the passing of employment equity and the premier, I remember one of the members went out and said to the premier, he was waiting in the lounge, and of course they make the final speech, eh? And she said, I don't know how she put it, but I said, how? And she came back, she said, you're going to make the final speech, which I was not, you know, prepared for. But anyway, as she, I said, what did you say? What did you do? She said, I just went out and told them that there are about 40 black people up in the stands. And there were, I looked up and I kept thinking, where are these people coming from? And you know, whatever. And so, but it wasn't making the final speech, it was getting it passed. I just felt, oh my God, we've got something, we've got that. That was one. The other was the initiation of the Black Secretariat, or what it was called then, with Juanita Westmoreland Traore. I just thought she was fabulous, and they had done such exquisite work to make things, to move that whole thing along, and to inject a kind of reality into government, and to make the civil servants a little more aware that the positions they had inherited simply by not being a person of color was not a position that they would have forever. Unfortunately, they were followed by another party that turned it all back again, but that was exciting to me. And the other was Stephen Lewis's report on education. By God, it was good. And it was written in 92. And it said, it's unfortunate. But if we pulled it out today and we put it on the table, it would still pertain, which doesn't say much for education. Because, you know, he just saw through it and wrote it as he saw it. And I was so elated with that, and that the changes that they were able to make in the Ministry of Education. We had books and programs that people today reach for and pull material from, and that was all stopped it was stopped officially with the next government, but that the fact that it was there, oh, I was excited. Those were, I think, the three moments when I said, God, you know, this is worth it.
Wow, fantastic. Yeah. And you've talked a bit about the kind of discrimination you faced in government. Mm-hmm. How did you fight that?
Well, you know, it's very hard to fight because no one sees themselves as being discriminated. And because government is so confining, I have to be truthful, I hated it. You know, I mean, it's you're not supposed to say this, and you're not supposed to say that, and you endure things that you know are ridiculous. The press was unconscionable. The press, they'd asked me where I lived and what I drove, and that would also be the subject of, you know, that the banter back and forth in the house. And I thought, what do you care where I live? And what car I'm driving. You know, isn't this a little ridiculous? I mean, this is nothing to do with anything. I remember one day I finally said to the press, you know, I have been reading and I know that all the other ministers have lived in houses and drove cars and drive cars. So why are you focusing on this? I really think the world had woken up and thought life had not evolved as it should have, because there's this woman there. And it didn't matter what they asked or why they asked it, you were not supposed to respond in kind. So I've often thought of that, and it just choked me, because I was accustomed to being more blunt than that, and I wasn't. They found every little the magazine. I told you that that was nonprofit, and of course. What's his, the lawyer, was it Mr. Evans? Evans was the commissioner at that time. Isn't that funny?
Great memory. Well, I would never remember that.
Well, you didn't have to go there. And he said, this is a nonprofit magazine. He said, what is he like? You're not making, I said, I know. We're putting out our money to put out the magazine, and then we're breaking even, but we're not making any money by the time. And he said, well, this isn't good. So then when that was over, they, what was it? They took me to rent review. And rent review usually takes a couple of months, maybe four, before you have the hearing, if that long. And they took 2 years. 2 years. Because while they were there, they could dance it out, and ask all stupid questions in the house. And then only to find that there was nothing there, that I hadn't been overcharging, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But in 2 years, for 2 years. And that was it. That was the issue that made me decide to leave, because I left early. I left about a year before. And that was the issue. I thought, my children are not going to have to suffer the embarrassment, of being nudged about something potentially illegal, because the stereotype of our race was always, oh, there's something going on here. And so I said, they're not going to have to do that. And after their father had died after I was in government a year. So I thought, these are issues whereby I'm making my living. With rental property, and of course rental property with the NDP was like the atomic bomb. Why do you have rental property? And I said, is the government going to provide enough spaces for people to live? That whole thing to me was a mystery. And of course there were others who also had rental.
So, must be so intimidating. Awful.
It was persecuting.
Yeah.
And if you look at any of us who have been in government, it's always, what do you own and where are you from, and I think there are people who still believe that Blacks should be in circumstances like they describe in Up From Slavery, Uncle Tom's Cabin or something. I really don't know why they dwell, but they always go for this.
Yes.
And it got tiresome. It got ridiculous. It was a determination I had. I thought, this is not for me. I should be outside of government, screaming as I do now.
Well, that's,
I should be one of those people out there saying, hey.
But on the other hand, it's important, right, for Black women to have their voices in politics. So what advice would you give to
Well, I'd give the advice that you decide who you are and really know who you are, because it's quite a different experience. Go and visit. Go and see whether you're a person who is successful at persuading others to do things and to think your way while you play the role and get your satisfaction that way. Or are you one who needs to be vocal outside and say, you know, this is not good enough. This is not, you know, apparent. You see, when we went to government, I think a lot of the people outside thought, well, they're there now, I can go home and rest. When I was working to get employment equity passed, I said to every Black person that I met, phoned, talked to, ran into, you have got to have your mouths open and say, this is what we need. We need employment equity so that it's outside and it's inside. Now, I think that's where my role is. I think that there are others, though, who are very good at pulling things together inside. And they are persuasive and they do their job effectively. And those people should go to government. But I think that you're in politics whether you're elected or not.
Well, and that's true. But you know, the conditions are your colleagues.
Yeah.
And whether they're anti-racist or not has a huge impact on your effectiveness. It's not.
It really does. Yeah. It really does. So I think that we need people in both spheres. I think that Black women, all women should go to government, that they should focus on their issues, that they should follow the line to the money. I mean, if you're looking at education because you have children or because you yourself think it's the growth of the province or the country depends on it, then you look at people who are willing to support public education, mm-hmm. because not everyone can afford to send their children to private school. And you focus on that. You don't give your money to some other part. If you're looking at long-term care and you think eventually, hey, you know, not everyone's going to be able to stay home, but if we had services that helped us to be at home, we could do that. You look at what you want and then you look at the money that they're giving for it, and that influences you. I try to encourage not only that women go into government, but that those who don't go into government realize that they are the government, and that if they open their mouths and they make the push and they write the article and they phone their members and they say this is good, and they phone them when they've done something well as when they've done something ridiculous, then they're still in government.
That is a great lesson. My last question is, what are the important lessons from your long history of mm-hmm. activism and political acumen for today's activists? But you've just said it all, haven't you? That's mm-hmm. Exactly.
Well,
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but to me,
no. But it is. It is. It's yeah. the way I feel. It's like when people say to me, "Well, you know, I wouldn't go to government." I say, "You don't have to go to government to be in government. You are the government, you know." And push. And the other thing is, people say, "Well, you know, those people are rich." I'd say there are more poor people and middle class than there are wealthy. And so you can do more. You just have to. I'm better at that. I'm better at that. I don't like the confining rules of government. And I'll tell you the truth. It may not be flattering for me, but I have to be truthful. I often resented the fact that we were told what to do by people whose names have never been on a ballot. And not it was suggested because I'm an expert and I know, and then you discuss it and then we decide. It was, you will do, you remember, you will do such and such. And I thought, well, why? Give me more reasons than that. So it's that kind of playing the game that is better suited for other people, and I give them that.
But that's interesting because don't you think that's a really male way of operating? Like, if we had more women and more black women and more women of color and indigenous women in government or in parliament,
Absolutely.
you think we'd operate that way?
No, that's a party I'd like to come to. That's a party I'd like to come to because you know that we would say, well, why? What are we doing that for? And how are you doing that? And you'd come to some conclusion. And it's true because I remember when women began to be promoted in jobs and roles more frequently. At first, there were those women who operated just like the men because that's the only leadership they'd ever seen, and you know how they were regarded. Like, let's move them along, and the others would be, well, wait a second, and they had a difficult time, and I think it's true. And maybe we shouldn't relax so much. Because I think that as long as this movement of women is in its relatively new stages, 20, 30 years is not old, it's new. As long as this movement of women, we still have that push. What we have to guard against is our settling in to allow that group to take the leadership. And as long as we have a memory, and you're this is part of that memory of the times when it was not that way, when we were told what to do, when we disliked it and we had to fight our way out of the paper bag, I think that we'll not go into the paper bag. So I'm all for creating that memory.
Yeah,
Yeah.
fantastic. That's fantastic, Zanana. Have we missed anything? Are there other things you'd like to add or embellish?
No, you've been very kind in listening to me this far. No, it's been a great journey. It started with education. It'll probably hopefully end that way because there's still a great deal of work to do in education. I think that it shows itself in the issues it has with race, also the issues it has with difference. And education is a field where they will make a decision or make a policy or write a law and figure it's done. But you have to be very careful about the people that you hire to initiate the policy.
Yeah.
And you have to be very careful about making sure that it continues to be done. And I think so. I think that the reason I still hold so determinedly to the importance of education is that it is an influencing tool that we can use to build our society in so many ways if we only remember that that's what you're doing. I used to teach at the university, teach teachers who were learning special to teach in special education situations, gifted as well as those who were challenged. And I would say to them, you know, they give you a certificate which says you're a teacher. They should really give you a certificate that says you're a paid influencer, because that's what you're doing. And you know, you've got to keep working at it, because otherwise we're going to go backwards. And I'm so afraid of that. You know, once you have grandchildren, you're afraid of everything. Once you have grandchildren, you're afraid of everything.
That's right. Well, we only have to look. I mean, the states for the last several years have been so horrendous, hasn't it? I mean,
It's like, I remember when I was a child, they used to have a paper. Many of the black men were employed to be paid well as porters. And they used to have they'd go to run to the states on the train and various other places. And they'd bring back a paper called the Chicago Defender. And the Chicago Defender, you know, when you get it, of course, you're getting it late because, you know, it's coming from there and it's coming to Toronto, and they'd bring enough and that certain people would pay them for the paper. And you'd read the paper and they would talk about the lynchings in the South and this. And this is when I was a child, and you know, and what happened and the unfairness of various situations. And you'd think, oh, yeah, it's bad, but it's getting better. It's bad, but it's not so bad. And, you know, you'd believe that, because I guess you had to believe it. But last year, in the last few years, when it's all become so evident, you suddenly realize that while we were not watching, you know, I mean, these things were happening, and this group of people would flare up, and then they wouldn't report it anymore. This other group of people would flare up, and they wouldn't report it anymore. And you thought to yourself, you know, it's gone backwards. It's gone backwards. Or maybe it never left. It was out of style for them to make that kind of noise. So it gives you the impression that you're not safe. You're never safe. You're never finished. This is never going to be over. This is a struggle that my children are waging, and their children will be waging, and it's going to go on forever. And I think that's the new belief I have. I used to think it would get better and then we could all relax. And I don't think so. And I think the same is true, I hate to tell you this, of women. I think that there's always going to be men and women who feel that our roles have changed too much, and too many of us are moving it toward that change. And I think that maybe that's what brings me to the fight, is those double issues, is that we're going to constantly have to watch. It's never going to become automatic. Yeah. We're going to constantly have to watch that our space isn't taken over again.
Yeah.
Differently.
I know. Well, I'm so glad you're still at it, Zanana. It's fantastic. As I said, a trailblazer to the end, I think.
I don't know, but certainly active, because I have no choice.
Yeah.
Really, we have no choice.
No.
We have no choice.
That's right.